Hey everyone, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. AI and accelerated computing have changed the cybersecurity landscape once again, and we're going to dive into Palo Alto Networks, a cybersecurity pure play, and how they're dealing with these changes.
Yeah, the biggest cybersecurity pure play out there, ticker symbol PANW. But as we often say, there are no moats in software. So let's break it down and see how these so-called moats for big companies like Palo Alto Networks are being changed and how the company can deal with it.
Before we continue, make sure you hit that subscribe button and consider joining our Semiconductor Insider membership. That membership gets you access over to our Discord server where we've been having conversations like this about cybersecurity, CNAPP, and what AI has done to the cybersecurity landscape.
Yeah, cybersecurity is a big deal. Semiconductors, chips, AI, all that stuff is interrelated. Cybersecurity is that layer that keeps it all safe. So big topic over there on the CSI Discord server. Check it out. Link is in the video description below.
There are no moats in software.
It's been a while since we reminded everybody what that actually means.
So when we've done Palo Alto in the past, we've mainly dug into the financials, but let's talk a little bit more about the business. And here's our trusty cybersecurity industry flowchart. Of course, it's a big industry, $215 billion in annual global spend in 2024. Those big bubbles on the left make up a big portion of it. And AI continues to change the game in cybersecurity. And we're going to double down on what we've said in the past. There's no moats in software. There's only the fastest car.
AI is basically accelerating this issue. And in particular, accelerating the problems that we were already seeing with mass adoption of the cloud. Organizations, and especially their employees, are doing reckless things with data that they ought not to do. And in addition to that, on the other end of the equation, there's the bad guys that are using AI to coordinate more sophisticated attacks. So where does AI come into this? Well, for Palo Alto Networks, it's all housed in that NGS, Next Gen Services. Annual recurring revenue surpassed $5 billion in this latest quarter, Q3 fiscal 2025, up 34% year over year. And remember the story last year for Palo Alto Networks was the so-called platformization where they were essentially giving away product for free for a period of time to make sure customers didn't just sign a last-minute contract with the old cybersecurity incumbent, even though they had told Palo Alto Networks, we're interested in your product, we want to consolidate our vendor cybersecurity vendor list. So in the midst of that, RPO, remaining performance obligation, remember it had dipped to the low teens percentage last year. A nice little bump, up 19% year over year, and RPO to $13.5 billion in this latest quarter.
And then here's their quarterly scorecard. Everything checks out, but we're going to put a little asterisk on the non-GAAP earnings per share. But everything else, total revenue up 15% year over year, gross margin, good. So let's talk a little bit more about that earnings per share later.
Yeah, and that all feeds into the there are no moats in software problem. And so here's an illustration of what that looks like. Because of the platformization, basically Palo Alto Networks providing some extra services without bringing in revenue and therefore lower profit in the last year, the company is still not meeting this rule of 40 test. Now, remember, this is not a reason to buy or sell a stock all on its own. The rule of 40 is just one valuation metric, but in Q1 2025, revenue growth of 15%, EBITDA margin of just shy of 19%, rule of 40 score of 34. We have still yet to see a more pronounced uptick in profitability yet because of platformization, and the AI investments are making this a bit of a more acute problem at the moment. Speaking of, Casey, walk us through the Q1 2025 free cash flow.
Cash provided from operating activities, $628.7 million in Q3. Purchases of property, equipment, and other assets, or CapEx, 68.3. That was elevated quite a bit from last year. We spent 37.4. And so we've talked about this with the trade desk as well. Developing software has changed, and you need to pay more attention to the infrastructure, especially in this AI era. Ultimately, free cash flow ended up $560 million, which is up 14% year over year. Operating leverage still not moving necessarily in the right direction during this whole platformization process.
Yeah. And right, we say that because remember, revenue grew 15%. So if there's positive operating leverage, you'd expect a cash profit metric like free cash flow to increase at least as much as revenue. Fiscal Q3, let's just chalk it up as another one-off in this year of platformization. But let's get back to the underlying problems for all of this, the no moats in software. And the reason why there's no moats is because software is a product in the fastest moving sector of the economy, technology. And so you are constantly having to move to the latest, most demanding customer need. And that's especially the case in cybersecurity. So here's one positive though, in the new AI race, Palo Alto Networks did land some big wins with this Prisma Access browser, or if you want another cybersecurity acronym, PAB. PAB licensed seats.
Is that a beer? PAB?
PAB. No, that's Pabst. That's Pabst. Pabst Blue Ribbon. Anyways.
Yeah, Pabst. That's right. So this is like a software-based firewall, right?
Yeah, think of this as like a firewall, like a fence of sorts to keep employees from doing things they shouldn't do when they're at work, like a fence around the web browser. And so maybe your employee is dealing with sensitive data, sensitive information, and they get the bright idea. I don't feel like reading this company report with sensitive data in it. I'm just going to stick it into Gemini and get an AI overview of this very sensitive information. This is a way for companies to put like a leash on their employees and what they do. Anyways, obviously a lot of interest in a product like this in the last year. And hopefully maybe we're providing some good work practice reminders for all of you.
Palo Alto realized that they're going to have to go a little bit further than that in doing some protection regarding those large language models. And so they acquired this Protect AI. And this is a really new company founded in 2022. And this also puts up a software-based firewall, but around the AI model itself. So that could be when it's being trained or maybe when it's operating the inference.
And also, Casey, what's red teaming?
Red teaming. When a cybersecurity team attempts to attack its own system to prove its worth, so to speak.
Yeah. And, and oftentimes I think they'll throw this up around a customer's IT system and then coordinate a test or simulate an attack to see if there's any issues. So this acquisition, Protect AI, it was probably a very small purchase. It was interesting, though, to hear how this acquisition came about in the first place. So CEO Nikesh Arora, on their Q&A session, was discussing how they have something like 36 AI models being trained and operated right now at Palo Alto Networks. And the board of directors had a moment and asked, what are we doing to protect ourselves with these models? What if these models do something we don't expect them to do? And then we leak our own data. We're the cybersecurity company. What are we doing to protect our own data with these models being trained and messed with? And so they said, we could build something or we can just go out there and see if there's anyone out there on the market that has built something already. And they found Protect AI. They made the acquisition. And like Casey said, this isn't just a leash for the employees. This is like a leash for the AI itself to make sure it stays within defined boundaries. I think this all circles back, though, to the fact that because it's software, it's a product, it costs money to make these pivots when customer demands change. And so growth came in pretty well this year. We're on track. So here's the slide from 3 months ago. This is their full year fiscal 2025 expectations as of February. Let's jump to the update now for as of May. And so this will be the quarter that ends in July in just a couple months.
So they increased the low end of their guidance on the revenue and adjusted profit, but overall they've increased the guidance to finish out the year in fiscal year 2025.
And the problem here, they're having to spend money again to make this pivot with customers in the AI era. So let's see how they do as we get into fiscal 2026. Maybe they can return to profitable growth or maybe I should say margin expansion again, profit margin growth. The stock did take a bit of a tumble, but do bear in mind, it is still up 17% in the last 12 months. Not terrible. That seems pretty reasonable given this is a north of $100 billion market cap business. We'll be looking for a return to more meaningful margin expansion in fiscal 2026. Where does that put us for expectations? We just did a brief reverse DCF. It's been a while since we did this on Palo Alto. Trailing 12-month free cash flow per share is now $3.46. And so based on that, here's the scenario we arrived at. We think the market kind of has embedded into these expectations as of now. Per share profit growth of about 25% for the next 5 years, and then a terminal growth rate of 5.5% thereafter, which is actually roughly in keeping with the IT sector overall, roughly just revenue alone. We're content to just sit on this one and see what happens. We think it's not a great value, like we need to see some imminent need to go out there and purchase more of, but it's not egregiously overpriced either, at least on a free cash flow basis. For us personally, that's what we're looking at. We're sitting pat with our position.